Dreams on. We're recording, so you know those slides and stuff. We're just going through them.
Yes.
You got that. We got. Oh, okay. So we need to fix. Hello, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So camera two.
Actually, no, because she's not going to be there for very long.
Okay, never mind. Hold on for a second. Thank God we got this fixed. So who's on camera two? Bree, you're on camera two. Okay.
Yes. So you saw
and Tyler is camera three, correct?
I was adjusting the
okay. Thank
once
you.
I got a decent level here,
good thing they have the same name. Perfect.
DB, I was adjusting. Let me put this on so both of them on the screen. I was bringing the stream up a little bit more.
Okay.
I was trying to keep these not too hot, so you know, because of all the paper rustling, and I'm coming up a little higher on those.
Should we fix camera one shot?
Camera one? Yes.
Yeah, if you could just. Oh, never mind. They're going.
Hello, my name's Carolyn. And I'm Elizabeth.
Yep.
And 10 months ago, we took an adventure, 14-hour flight out to Tokyo, Japan, where we interned with Tokyo City University. We helped out in classrooms, in club meetings,
yep.
At lunch, and we helped out at other schools and worked one-on-one with some adult English learners. All students we worked with were of all ages and all English capabilities.
I can hear you guys in this.
That's what happened.
So some background on this experience. Back in February of 2017, there were eight students along with one professor who came from Tokyo City University.
Yeah, I can hear you.
This professor was Steve Crane, and he created a project with Professor Werner DeLauer of the Environmental Science Department here on campus, and they created an exchange program. So after the students came and they spent a week with us here at Franklin Pierce, Professor Crane decided to have two students come from Franklin Pierce to Tokyo City University. Out of the campus, a couple people applied, and we ended up being picked to go. So we chose May 24th to July 5th, and we went on our six-week journey.
That's okay.
So on May 24th, we both took our first plane trip, which was a terrifying experience that Carolyn walked me through. It was both of our first times, but she definitely held together far better than I did. After 14 hours, we landed in Tokyo, and Professor Stephen Cranes and a friend of ours, Kenta Kikumoto, picked us up, and we got to our share house at 1 o'clock in the morning, where we set up our bed and our futon.
That's what they're talking about now.
Oh, okay, good.
Yes, the 1-inch thick futon, by the way. So the internship itself demanded us to travel between two of the three Tokyo City University campuses. We were tasked with just helping out teachers wherever they needed us. So in the classroom, outside the classroom, we did our own English presentations to show what an English presentation might sound and look like, how conversations can flow in English. A lot of the people we worked with could read English. They were literate, unlike us, who were not literate in Japanese. So communicating them with written language and with photographs was really easy. Communicating in conversation was a lot harder. So in order to get through the language barrier, we used photographs and body language in very conscious, simplified conversations to get us through.
Of course.
Simply either finding our way through the subway system or helping a graduate student with critiques on their own presentations for their senior thesis. So the first days we were there, we had to get over jet lag. And with 14 hours, with a 13-hour time difference, it takes a while. We ended up taking about a week and a half to get over this. Doesn't help if you take long naps. If you take long naps, it throws the whole thing off. So, word of advice, don't do that. But beyond that, our real big challenge was simply to understand and get to know our surroundings. This was a totally different world. And a lot of signs, while in English, were very complicated, and a lot of names of stations we had to learn were beyond our own comprehension. We had to rely on a map that looked kind of like a diagram. Crazy stuff. But in the midst of it, we got to know the Tokyo City University English Department community, and they were probably the kindest group of and most welcoming group of individuals we got to work with while in Tokyo.
So our daily commute. We spent over 4 hours a day on the train. We went to all three campuses most days, so we would be traveling back and forth. Most of our days began around 8 a.m. at the campuses, and we would not return back to the share house until past 11 p.m. So it was very long hours for a very long 6 weeks, but it was definitely worth it.
Oh yeah.
A little aspect of Japan culture is that when you use the trains during rush hour, they pack you in as close as possible. And in order to do so, they actually physically push you up against other people, and they shove more and more in until you are all held up by each other's just strength.
Yeah.
So the first campus that we went to primarily was Yokohama campus. And Yokohama campus focuses on environmentalism. So we spent a lot of time here with Stephen and his classes learning about English and global problems and helping out with various projects the students had. Another thing that we did at this campus was the English Speaking Society. So the English Speaking Society, we just called it ESS. It was a group of students who have been working for a few years on their English conversation skills. So we played games and watched movies and had general discussions with them to help strengthen their ability to speak English.
We also went to Setagaya campus, and this campus is located closer to central Tokyo. It is the main campus of the originally founded engineering school that Tokyo City University was. Now it is a closer related to a liberal arts school, specializing in engineering and environmental studies. Setagaya campus has a lot of engineering students, and our role really when we visited wasn't so much to help out in that many classrooms. We visited no more than three each week, but we were there to visit students practicing English for presentations, which was a real common theme, partly because in their university, the best application for English in its practice in their field is in presenting their research on a global scale. And they needed to know English as it is the key global language at the moment. So our role was really to help these students express their ideas in a language that they really weren't that comfortable communicating in. We also visited Hiro'o, which is it's knocking on the door of the central hub of Tokyo where you'd find Tokyo Tower. We worked with kids ages 6 to 12. There were 20 students in this little tiny program with 6 adult teachers, including us making it 8 student teachers. We had, we went to this school after Setagaya campus, and during our time there, we helped with their learning booklets. They were learning with audio tapes and little booklets that they filled out. And their teachers really were the books, but our goal was to kind of get them excited about learning English, to motivate them to want to learn and to want to speak and ask questions. So we'd play games, we'd read them stories, and share snack time with them. We also, this program itself is an extension of Iego Quest, which is a Japanese and international language speaking program to help kids after schools and after those hours to get the practice they need in order to get into higher level schools. Through Iego Quest, they visit 3 times a year to Tohoku, and Tohoku is in a few hours north of Tokyo. Tohoku is the site which the Tohoku earthquake in 2011 hit the hardest. A lot of people had passed away in this very ferocious and life-changing earthquake and tsunami. So Iego Quest for the last few years has gone and visited this area, visiting 2 schools, Hyokushu and Tohoku, or sorry, not Tohoku, Onagawa, Onagawa Daycare. We visited these little kids and sang songs with them. We read books to them. We did English speaking practice just in a day visit. This was many of their first time seeing Americans and first time seeing foreigners of any kind. So a lot of these kids had goggled eyes when they first met us. They didn't know what to think because we looked so different. It was very exciting, and they had rehearsed some thank you songs for us when we finished our time there. We had a rehearsed almost play the way we did it. We worked with the teachers at Iego Quest that we worked with. They helped us kind of create a production where the kids came in and were an audience to us telling them stories. And that was a really powerful time for us because a lot of these kids had lost friends and families. A lot of them remembered the earthquake and tsunami themselves. Many of the teachers had lost students and lost family members during that period as well. So we got to hear about their stories during that time, and we got to enlighten and spend a little bit of time with the students and just better their time there. It's a neat program, and we were really lucky to help support that program.
So in the first 4 weeks that we were here in Tokyo, we spent our time at a share house with 150 other foreigners. But in our last 2 weeks, we got the opportunity to live with Japanese families in homestays. And this was some of the most influential weeks that we did have. And we both actually got to go to different families. So Carolyn's gonna give you her experience first.
All right. So I stayed with the Yokote family. Shio, my host mom, looked after me during the next 2 weeks of my stay. We lived in Roppongi, which is just outside of Tokyo Tower. It's the center hub of Tokyo. That's in the far picture to the left, my left, your right, is myself, Shio, and her daughter Riko. And in the happy birthday picture, there are her three kids. Riko is 7, and she became one of my best friends in Tokyo. She let me use her bedroom while I was there, and she slept with her mom while I was staying, and she was really kind and generous. And then her twin brothers, Kichi and Katsu. And Kichi and Katsu were comparable to hyperactive monkeys, and were constantly running around or holding my hand or unpacking my stuff or touching my stuff, and stuff became relative by the end. They could just do whatever they wanted with my bags. But we went on a lot of adventures. We visited family friends, and the far picture there, we visited Ginza. So those are the kids and myself all parading down the main street there. We ventured out to Mount Fuji area, just myself, Shio, Riko, and her piano teacher. We went to visit Shio's grandfather, and we visited a couple of the scenic touristy sites. And they wanted to treat me, they treated me with such generosity and kindness throughout my whole time there. They wanted to cater all of their stay around things that I was interested in, and things around Riko was interested in as well. So they knew, I had explained to them that I liked pottery, and so they went ahead and contacted a family friend, and they arranged for me to work and throw with this man and during one of our travels down there. And he was so kind, and I actually didn't know he spoke English until halfway through our visit, and he looks at me and says, "Would you like to work with some clay too?" Yes, please. So that was highlight of my stay. We also went to Ninja Village, which is what I usually tell people when I say I went to Japan. I went to Ninja Village and saw real ninjas, where they actually train a lot of the actors who do ninja work in movies. So that was fun. We got to see demonstrations and play games. And Riko really liked Ninja Village. So during my time there, the generosity that they showed me, and the kindness and amount of work it took them to cater to someone who spoke English, as many of them did not speak English. Shio spoke a little. And the kids all spoke English, but it took a long time for them to trust me and to get used to me being in their house as a family member than a week. week ago, I was a complete stranger on the street. So it took a while for us to actually start communicating what my needs were as someone who just loves trying new things but didn't want to impose or anything, wanted to go on adventures but didn't know how to go about it best and how to communicate with my schedule and my work schedule and theirs. It took a while. I used the same techniques I used in the classroom, where lots of visuals, lots of pictures, especially when I talked about pottery and clay. I would bring up whatever I was doing, what my professors were doing in clay, and use those to tell stories about myself. So eventually we all got to trust each other and get to know each other. I became a sibling. I always wanted to have a little sister. I already have two little brothers, but I liked having the addition. But I also became a teacher, as I know English very well, and they had English homework. So part of how I paid them back for everything that they did for me was in helping them with their homework. And I became a student. Those kids and Shio and their whole family and friends became an extended community for me that taught me about Japan, not through the eyes of a tourist, but through the eyes of someone who lived there. So instead of being an outsider, I could get a little glimpse of what it was like to actually be in that country as someone who's grown up there. And it provided me new insight to travel itself and to being accepted into a community and how to join a community and support them too, as much as they were supporting me. And that really is the takeaway, and how throughout this entire experience, we had so many unknowns, a lot of mysteries, and it really was the people who helped us who got us through.
So my host family experience was slightly different than Carolyn's. I got to go with two different families. So the thing that linked these families together was a Down syndrome organization founded by my first host family. Both host families had a daughter with Down syndrome, and it really added a very beautiful aspect to being with these host families. So the picture in the middle is of the Hasabe family. Their daughter's name is Nana, and she's 7. And the mother's name is Manami, and her husband is Nao. So Manami and I grew very close. We traveled around Tokyo together as tourists, and this was the first time she had ever had that experience. She had always grown up there, so going on all these touristy adventures and having Carolyn over, she was so excited to get to experience Japan through an American's eyes. And she really opened up to me in the week that we spent together about what it's like to have a daughter with Down syndrome in a country which doesn't accept that. And so she started a foundation which uses yoga to help teach parents how to accept their children and how to really enrich the child's life. So my second host family, if you look to the left side of the screen for you guys, the youngest is Nana as well, and the oldest is Lala. So on the right side is Akane. And Akane and I grew to be very close confidants. We would stay up until 2-3 o'clock in the morning every night talking about what it was like to live in another country and our thoughts and our feelings on children and relationships and marriage. And she really took the chance to be very open that she hadn't had before within her life. And so this kind of opened me up to a very community effort style of living. Kind of a funny aspect of my time there, which was both parts funny and frustrating, was that I'm allergic to dairy, apples, gluten, and onions, and I'm anaphylactic to onions, and I can't read Japanese. So when I went shopping for food, I always had to have somebody with me, and if we went out somewhere, I always had to have somebody checking for me, and I could never double check myself. So if I ate something that had onion in it, I could have gotten very sick. So I had to learn how to rely on other people to take care of me in that way. And that was something I was very new to. I'm very much more comfortable being able to double check myself, but being able to have this whole community and people that I had never met before care so much about me and my well-being was absolutely amazing. And so that goes to my perspective. I think the main thing I took from Japan was community. Going to Tohoku, it there's been nothing in my life like this. We walked on the same ground where 18,000 people were killed by a wave 40 meters high. And we walked in the halls where children had died and their teachers walked past them. It was absolutely heartbreaking. And coming back, I think about that every day, and I think about that experience and how those teachers never stopped. They still teach students today, and they have children today that they lost their whole families, they lost their houses, and yet they're so full of love and so full of understanding that they just want to make sure that the kids today have a chance. And that honestly has made my life so much better.
So thank you guys for listening to us and joining us today. We wanted to thank the Karinas family and Verna DeLauer for really orienting and getting this trip possible, and to our host families and to all of our friends and families who supported us to get there and to come home, and both in the U.S. and back in Japan. So thank you.
We'd also like to shout out to the Japanese students who go here, Konomi, Yuri, Kasumi, and Taki. Thank you for all of your help in preparing us and understanding what Japan was going to be like. So are there any questions? Yes?
Do either of you think you're going to continue to be involved with Japan and Japanese elements in your future careers when you leave here?
So I would love to go back and teach for another year. My second host mother, Akane, has offered me her home again. So I'm thinking of going back in the coming years because she's very excited to have me and have me work for her.
Mm-hmm. There's a couple English teaching programs you can go through to go back. I'm thinking I would go through one of those as a full-time payroll employee if I could. So I'm looking into it in my exploration of grad school programs and post-bac programs. I'm seriously considering going back to Japan. I would really like to go back.
Yeah?
I had a thought. I'm having a hard time formulating into a question, but I thought it was really interesting how you brought up the family with Down syndrome, how they were very accepting, but it's kind of like a taboo thing in Japan. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if you could speak a little more about that, like maybe why that way in that country?
Of course. So the way my first host mother had explained it to me was that Japan is a country where you kind of want to fit in with everybody else. So having a child who doesn't necessarily fit that view of what a normal child will be like, it kind of makes it so that the mother feels as though they should hide their children. So in the first few years of Nana's life, Manami had a very hard time bringing her out in public because it brought a lot of attention. But she slowly learned that she loves her child so much and that she deserves to have the same life as anybody else and the same opportunities. So now she's trying to activate and be an activist with other parents and other families to educate them about what it's like to have a child with disabilities and that they deserve to go out and see the world as well.
We have just a few more minutes. Is there any last, maybe two more questions?
Yeah. Why did you decide, what made you so interested in going to Japan? Because I know that you have like other Japanese students here, but why did you decide?
Verna DeLauer, I had her in a class, I had her in Nature and Culture, and at the time she was really involved in the trying to get Japanese students and Franklin Pierce students to communicate through Skype and try and do an exchange program. So I had always wanted to travel abroad, and I've been interested in Japan and in a lot of Asian cultures growing up. So this spoke to me just as the perfect chance. So I had applied and was really blessed to have gotten in. So.
And I think that's all the time we have. All right, okay. So thank you all so much.